yapping and chatting. Make sure to keep that vibe going. We will be back on stage in some time. Like I said, go get your coffees, go get food, and relax and chill, and we'll catch you in a bit. Thank you. We have journeyed long and far as women and non-binary people in technology over the years, and to see a room full of people here who are committed to changing the narrative is just incredibly promising, and also tells you that there are so many of us who are joining hands in ensuring more equitable, safe workplaces, workplaces where we're seen, heard, and held for who we are, and celebrate all of ourselves in the way we show up at work and outside of work. And what better way to build communities other than collaborating with communities? We not only have our partners and sponsor organizations, we also have collaborative partnership organizations here. We have representations from across cross-section of work areas, the diversity in this room. We have creative people, we have people from tech, we have people from reputation, we have people across the board who have joined hands to be sitting here, and it's just joyful to see and feel the vibe that we're creating here. It's going to go a long way because we're just starting, and the party that is beginning just now is going to become a frenzy at some point, because this is going to become 15,000 people, 30,000 people, more, more, more. As long as we can have everybody represented in spaces like this and make sure that we pass the baton on to people as this goes along is inspiring to start off with, and humbling, and also a measure of how much work that needs to really happen and get done. Conversations that stay conversations, monologues that are two that become that don't become a dialogue are not the things that we want at the table. We want action for change, we want commitment to make that change happen, and we want to do it together. And that's the joy of working in a space like this. So, I don't know, how many of you here have been associated with Anita B before? Woohoo! How many of you here for the first time are coming into a space? Okay, that's almost half and half, equal splits. So it's great, firstly, to see the two worlds colliding in some form, and to say that Anita B in India has been a long-standing journey, and the work that Anita B has managed to achieve and do and work with in India also is very, very inspiring. So picking up from where we left off a few years ago, we're back here to commit ourselves to all of that and more. I'm not going to say much more. I'll just read out a few statistics and numbers that are as recent as 2022, so we just refresh and align ourselves to see where we are. So there was a recent AIM research report where it said the tech industry in India has a total of 4.6 million employees, of which only 1.3 million, which is 29%, are women. Globally, only 5.31% of women work in STEM fields, while 1.42% are non-binary, and 1% are openly transgender as of 2022. And now that 1% openly transgender is important because a lot of workspaces don't allow the room or the journeys that people have had. They don't feel comfortable sharing who they are in entirety. So these numbers are also a little bit under the radar because a lot of people aren't open in speaking about this, right? So that means that the work that we need to do is that much more. Now, without further ado, we have somebody who's traveled all the way from the US. She was at the Qatar Web Summit and she just spoke. And somebody who I have seen over the years inspiring people, not because of her journey, not because of her career, because her heart, body, mind, and soul is the passion that she drives as her fuel to work with on these aspects of safety, of inclusion, of diversity, of sustainability, of social, environmental governance, all of these pieces coming together. Most of you, if you've worked with Anita B before, know what a rock star she is. She ended our conference last year, which happened at Orlando, Florida, with a t-shirt that said we out because Florida does not support the LGBTQIA community, and the conference has now moved to Philly in the US. To be able to take drastic steps to ensure that we don't perpetuate the world and its status quo is something that she holds as she wears on her sleeve And it's an honor and pleasure to have had Brenda Darden Wilkerson join us here today. Brenda, thank you so much for traveling. And she's, of course, the president and CEO of AnitaB.org. I'm assuming all of you have seen the invite. So there is no doubt in the fact that this person I'm welcoming on stage is the person that's going to talk to us about her journey and all of the traversed worlds that she has occupied. So Brenda, I'm going to now join you.
Okay. Awesome.
Okay. So,
well, hello, everybody. I think I got to extend a hand to everybody. If I didn't, I want to make sure I do afterwards. It's so great to see you all here. I really can't tell you how my heart is warmed by looking out and seeing all your faces. Some familiar, some new. We started this journey, my predecessor actually started this journey way back before 2006. And when I took over, I think I was maybe 2 months in, and I got to come over and visit and meet the community and be a part of the community. And it's been a part of me ever since. Just the power. I don't know. I mean, I'm looking at a lot of women here, but I'm looking at the men too. Do you realize the power that's in this community? The smarts, the know-how, the space for innovation that you have within your midst, and some that we haven't counted, and the desire to support others and to grow the community. That is a characteristic that just stands out to me. And so I haven't been here, I've shared with some, I haven't been back since 2019. I'm apologizing for that. I cannot believe that it's been that long. I love being here. But I, first of all, thank you for all those amazing things you said about me, really good grief. I'm humbled. But this woman here is the powerhouse. And she's been part of our community. And so when she said she wanted to actually come on and run this unit, I was honored and excited. And she has done so many things so soon. I can't wait to see what's to come.
Brenda, I just follow in on the footsteps that are so neatly laid, but not just Brenda, but by so many of you in the room who have had the honor, privilege, and joy of knowing and learning from, right? When I see the journeys that we've been on, and Brenda, I want to talk to you a little bit about your journey, because I think people in the room would love to know, because today's conversation is not only about what we need to do, but also about a little bit about you and your journey, and how inspiring it is for the people that, you know, where are my colleagues? Are my colleagues in the room? No, I think they're busy doing something. But, you know, every day when we come and we live our life on Zoom, because most of us work remotely, and when we join the call, there is a gratitude that we say every day, and the gratitude is, thank God we work in this space. Mm-hmm. It's such a privilege to have access to the kind of knowledge, to the kind of colleagues that we have, to the kind of passion that really flows in our veins when this is the work we do. So Brenda, my first question to you is about that. Tell us your journey to what brought you here to create and craft what we're doing collectively and collaboratively, and tell the room a little bit about that.
Well, yeah, I mean, I have to say my journey has been somewhat accidental. I grew up I'm one of four kids, and both my parents were educators. My father was also a journalist. And they had two kids, and they thought they were done. And then 10 years later came me, and 5 years later, a younger sister. So there's like two groups of people. And my older brother and sister, my sister's a lawyer, my brother was an accountant, so my mother needed a doctor. And that was going to be me. And I was actually very creative, and we did all that stuff, you know, music and dance and all that. And my mother said, yeah, but that's not what you do. You're going to be the doctor. So I thought, okay. And so actually I had studied pre-med, and I was all the way to junior year when I just got discontented with the way medicine is practiced in the U.S. But now what do I do? My whole life I've been told I'm going to be a doctor, right? As luck would have it, at my university, I was studying biomedical engineering, and all engineers had to have two programming classes. And that was actually my first access to programming. And so as I'm trying to figure out now, what do I do with my life? I thought, I'm kind of good at this thing. It's new to me. I hadn't been exposed to it. And that started my journey that has now obviously shaped the whole trajectory of my career. So I did, you know, a whole stint in corporate, all the way up the ladder, you know, from programmer all the way up. But when I became pregnant with our first son, I just could not, okay, here's the age thing, okay. I just could not see myself wearing that beeper and babysitting the software at night while I was, you know, taking care of my children. And so I then left and went into education. And that's where I found my spark, because I met other people that could have been me. These are people who, and you know, I went to work at a community college, a junior college, in a continuing ed section. And so these are people who were somewhere between 20 and 80, literally, who would come to my classes at night to learn tech because they wanted to get into it. And the reason why I say they could have been me is because these were people who either hadn't been exposed or had been talked out of it. That's not for you, little girl. Or you're not good at math, because there's this assumption, even though we know the data doesn't show this is correct, that women aren't good at math. We know we beat the pants off the guys, right? Right, ladies? Back me up. Okay. And so here I am with these people who many of them had master's degrees in other things, creating a bridge for them to get into tech. And that's when that spark hit me. I thought, that could have been me, right? Because I accidentally learned about computer science as I was studying engineering. It wasn't available in my high school growing up for all types of bias reasons. Yeah. And so there were women who had been told they weren't good at STEM, but they actually were. There were men who, for whatever reason, had been told that, you know, you shouldn't do this, and they had been steered away. And so that led me to, by the time this opportunity came along, to say, if I could do something to make sure that the table where tech is created looks like the people it's created for, sign me up.
And talking about tech and coming to Anita B now, a little bit about the journey of Anita B itself globally. Yes. If you can tell us the multiple, you know, ways, access points, pathways, yes, a little bit about what we do so that those in the room that are interacting with us for the first time know, and we reiterate it for those of you who know us, yeah, really well inside out. So
yeah, we do so many things because people are on different parts of their journeys, right? So we work with students who may be isolated in their universities, and they may not have mentors, and or they may, you know, be getting talked out of, as many of us are talked out of staying on that technical track. And so we create a community for them so that they know they have exposure to women who are doing the types of things that they're interested in, or maybe even doing things that they never even knew that they could do, and they have that now exposure. We also work with the professors and the provosts and universities to make sure that the culture that they're creating is more conducive to having a more diverse community within that space. And that some of those bad habits that get created, that are in tech, we think are created in tech, they actually start at university, right? And so we help them to try to consider that and to make some changes. So we work all the way up the ecosystem for women and non-binary technologists. So the places where they learn, places where they work, and places where they get funded to provide first that education for those environments that many times people, you know, the status quo is easy because we've always done it that way. So maybe sometimes people just don't know what they're doing in their policies and their practices that are perpetuating the divide that we find many times. So we do that education. Of course, we run the largest women in tech conference in the world, the Grace Hopper Celebration. So excited to have it come back here in India. And that is a space where we do so many important things. But one of the most important things that I think we do there is we put women on the stage to tell their stories about the important work that they're doing. One bad habit we have as women is we just don't talk about what we do, right? You know, we could be charting, you know, a rocket to the moon, but we're not, when we go home and we're cooking and we're taking care of, we don't talk about that stuff, right? So we make it all the way through our lives many times, not being exposed for the important contributions that we make. So that stage is really important, and it does a lot of things. It inspires others. It breaks the myths that we don't exist, right? And we aren't doing things. And it also gives a launching platform many times for women who then find their partners for business, or they find staff that help them grow their business, or they find funders who help them also grow their business. So we create, at the end of the day, we create community. Yeah. Because we're a community here together. It's so important, right, to be together. That's why it's fun to be here tonight, right? Because we get to see each other and learn from each other and get exposed. We also have, and this was pretty much born out of the out of COVID. We had planned to do it before, but you know, it became a necessity. We created a membership platform so that when we couldn't be together physically, or like when I go home, I can still reach out and have access to each other on this physical, on this virtual platform.
Yeah, and the virtual platform is over 75,000 people around the world, and over almost touching 5,000 people in India, and many of our community members are here. Yes. And I think the joy of community is to be able to access each other, and in some form it becomes such a beautiful support system. Yes. And there are so many community leaders here actually in different forms and ways. Like I can see about, there's somebody who runs Wow Kitty, Jacinta runs Hope Works Foundation, Anju ran the 100 Sari Pact. I may be missing a few, but there are so many people who have resourced in the idea of community. And I love how that's the backbone of everything that we do at Anita B. Speaking to that, I want to ask you a little bit about the vision and the mission that we have from now on and to the future at Anita B, and what we want to do with our communities and the people that we work with.
Yeah. Well, in, you know, we are not going to stop any of the things that we've already done. But in addition, we want to increase the pathways into leadership for women. We know that as goes the head, so goes the body. And so if we have more women in leadership, we know that some of these issues that we are addressing will go away. There is a level of empathy that comes from having a certain number of people at the table that are representative of populations that our businesses all serve, right? We're going to be more successful in business if we create solutions that actually serve populations, not solutions that many of them have to cope with. And, you know, again, here's a weird thing to say, but as women, we've been coping with solutions that were not good for us. We have the empathy to bring that to the table. And so we want to build those pathways into leadership, not to, you know, excuse me, erase anyone else, but just to make sure that the representation is there, that we all learn what it means to work together and to have different ideas and different perspectives. You know, I heard Shreya say earlier, you know, diversity is all kinds of things. What did you say, Shreya?
I said diversity is not just having different genders at the table, but it's also having the optimist, the pessimist, the lazy one, the active one, because it's also intersectional in time in terms of who you bring to the table is going to decide what you design, right? I saw a TED talk recently where he was saying, so many architects don't even design thinking women. You know, cars are not, car seat belts and car safety is not designed for women. And Brenda and I were talking and saying, for the first time, after all the years of menstrual pads being used, they've tested with real blood this year, 2023. It's taken that long for a menstrual product to be tested with blood when it's used for 50% of the population at least, right? Yeah. So diversity needs to be not just physical, not just differently able, not just gender, but it's also personality.
Yeah.
And when you have different personalities at the table, you're able to design better, innovate better, think better. Yeah,
and that's where innovation comes from. When we're all looking around and we all speak the same language and we all went to the same school and we all, you know, I don't go out and do the same things after work, after a while, we're just kind of, you know, completing each other's sentences and we're nodding our heads and it feels really comfortable. But it's the tension that creates the innovation. It's when someone forces you to think differently is when different things happen. And so that diversity at the table is really important. Now, sometimes it's hard because, like I said, it's comfortable. If I don't have to think very hard about what you're saying, if I don't have to listen really hard, it's more comfortable for me. But what do I want, comfort, or do I really want to serve and have success? And I think we want we really want both, right? And we can get both, but there's work to it. We have to work to get to the place where we really are serving all of our populations and that we're comfortable doing so. Absolutely. And we're here to help do that.
Yes. And Brenda, I want to talk to you a little bit about, I love what Bo said about, corrective over protective.
Yes, yes.
And I love the way you tell that story. Yeah. So can you just share that story with the audience as well?
So recently, we did a huge restructure at AnitaB.org. And one of the things we've done is we created a whole different flywheel. I've been very much for-profit most of my life. And so I wanted to bring some of that flair to the nonprofit space so that we could be agile and we could be able to produce new products as our customers need them. As many of you heard me say, I want to hear from you. What is it that you need so that we can create the things that actually serve you now? It's different from maybe a year ago or 5 years ago, right? So we always want to be moving forward and ahead. And so as we were having this discussion, Bo Young Lee, who is an amazing person, if you don't know her, you've got to look her up. Excuse me, she is amazing. So she says to me, she said, Brenda, so are you thinking of making solutions that are more corrective or are they protective? I think your solutions are corrective. I was like, no, they're not. We want to protect people, because that's the first thing that you think about. And then as we thought about it and we talked about it, she says, no, I don't think so. I think you're correct. And in my background, one of the initiatives that I worked on was called Computer Science for All, where we added computer science to the curriculum of every student in the district that I worked in. And then I got to work with the Obama administration to do the same thing. And she said, now when you think about it, is that protective or corrective? It actually corrected the issue that we were having, which is that many students were not exposed, yeah. Right? It was only in the most elite spots or where they happened to have teachers. And so we did a whole bunch of work to make sure that there were teachers and curriculum and everybody graduated. And let me tell you, it's a revolution. It is a revolution. Students leave knowing their choices, which is the definition of freedom, in my opinion. Yeah. So I stood corrected. And so as we think about what we're our work going forward, many times it's easier to protect something. When you think about, you just remove it from the environment that's harmful. That's not what we want to do. We don't want to remove anybody from the place where tech is created. We want more people there, which means we have to correct the things that were keeping people from being there. Is it the policies? Is it the procedures? Is it the culture? What about what we're doing that we've always done is keeping us from moving forward? So the work that we're doing together is to address those things. And we don't assume one size fits all. That's the other thing. Normally people come up with this solution and that's the solution. And so we're working with companies and universities and funders to say, let's talk about what's going on in your company and what do you need and let us help you. Let us be your partner and let's all learn together so we can correct.
Yeah. So that story really inspires me because correction is so necessary because I think in India there's always this need to protect first. First ourselves, so we remove ourselves from spaces, then people close to us, we want them to be removed from spaces. The work is so much in the corrective, and that's what excites me. So turning the now lens towards India, and so I want to ask you, Brenda, what are you looking forward to from, bringing ourselves back in and infusing the system? What are you looking forward to from an India perspective? And then I'll speak to what we're going to do.
Yeah, I am looking forward to first and foremost rebuilding the connections between our communities. Yeah. They were so amazing. They're still there, right? Yeah. We all still know each other. Maybe we don't meet as often. We don't get to impact each other as often. We want to turn that the volume on that and make sure that people have access to each other, they have access to learning if they're students, that they have access to all of the things that will make it so that they can get in and stay in tech. So many times we get in and we leave. I hate to talk about age, but I was 35 when I left. Right? It got to that point, I had had my fill, I had had enough, I couldn't do that and take care of my family. We want to make sure that over half of the population doesn't have to leave because these other things they have to do.
Yes.
Right? And that starts with rebuilding the community.
Yeah.
And then we want to work with our corporate partners and our university partners to help them be all they can be, whatever that means. For some, it means that we will help them create programs like returnships so women can come back after they've had their baby or been out for a while. For some, it will mean that we help them put together focus groups that are focused on various populations, especially as we increase our attention on the non-binary population. That's a newer initiative for us. Maybe it's just creating a community of companies together. One positive thing that came out of COVID is that because everyone was suffering, competitors sat down at the table together and talked about the things that they had in common that were struggles. That was great because, you know, yeah, we might be competing in product, but for the things that we have in common, we really should be using each other as resources. And so if we can be that conduit, yeah, then we can do that. That's just a little bit. We want to do so much more, and Shreya will tell you.
Yeah, I mean, I think when we started looking at India, the first thing we recognized was there's not enough data, especially when it comes to the non-binary, the differently abled. We don't have enough information. And one of the most important things is for us to know the numbers, because otherwise we don't even know what we're dealing with. While we know the population, while we know the problems, we really need tangible numbers. So the first thing that we're going to start working on is to really start collecting data. And like Brenda was saying, it's important for organizations that we work with to de-aggregate their data so we can really look at it across the board and see where these patterns are emerging, because data speaks so much. And if we can use that to leverage to really build the backing for us to know what we're dealing with, it'll help us a lot more better to transform what is currently strategy into something that's actionable for change. Mm-hmm. So to really look at that, that's one. Two, like I said, we have a 5,000 member active community, and that membership is now going to open up into the global community. And as community members, there's a lot of access, right? There's access to mentorship, there's access to education, there's access to training programs, there's access to live sessions, you can come together. The entire bunch, we have a couple of community folks here who actually travel from two different cities to help us and support us. And they've already started working on a project with Evidya Loka to introduce STEM education to girl children in rural parts of our country. They've already put together the curriculum in the last 3 weeks, and the enthusiasm, yeah, I think that deserves a round of applause, because these are 20-something, just out of college, youngsters who are saying, we will do this, we want to do this. And, you know, to see that kind of spark, it's just, so the community is driving that impact. So we really want to work across the board with girl child education in STEM roles, all the way up to women in senior leadership, you know. So the entire spectrum of that, and so much to the non-binary also. I think it's about time that women and non-binaries use the way we're using it right now. So many people said, but this is the first time you're saying it. I said, yeah, a little too late, but better late than never.
Yes.
So
absolutely.
So to work with the entire spectrum of people and to support them. Year one is going to be a little slow. We're introducing two programs, two Abbey Awards. We're trying to see and create a partner system collaboration. Interweave is in the house, Assistive Technology Foundation, HopeWorks. You know, there are so many collaborators from the fraternity that are here. And that goes to show that our work is going to be intersectional, and we're going to be achieving this a lot better together, stronger together. So that's another thing that we're going to do. With our corporate partners, we have the Apprenticeship Pathway Program, we have the Return to Work Program. Those are the programs that we'll be bringing in. There are a lot of requests for roundtables, senior leadership conversations in tech, AI, generative AI is sort of coming out of my ears, because that's all I've been hearing for the last so many months. So there's so much work to be done in that space. So we're looking at the ecosystem and saying, okay, this year we're going to pick two or three programs and we want to see through to the end of the year. We want to work with our corporate partners, our academic partners, to ensure that we see this sort of slow, steady growth. And the next year we will introduce a few more. And as we go on, we're going to be a microcosm of whatever Anita B does in the US, we will be doing in India as well. And the good news is, as part of that, Grace Hopper Celebration India is happening on the November 20th, 21st, and 22nd of this year. It's happening in Bangalore at BIEC. We have multiple tracks. We have an executive leadership track. We have a DEIB track. We have a media track. We're trying to introduce this, like we said, across the spectrum, because I love what you said. It's not a pipeline. There are multiple pathways to it. And I think to infuse those pathways into the learning networking ground that GHCI is something that we want to do. So, whole bunch of these things across these five areas are what we're starting with. And we've started off with already speaking to so many of you. So we're very encouraged and looking forward to what we have in store. More than anything else, I think we also want to create infinite platforms and webinars and spaces for women, non-binary people to come, meet, share their stories, and collaborate. Yeah, so Brenda, yes, that's what we plan.
And we want to listen. Because again, things change, yeah, right? And we are here, I always say this, we don't exist for our own sake. Yeah. We are here to serve. And we believe if we serve together, we're going to scale on a massive size. If we can get people who are solving problems for people who are not getting their problems solved now, think of the impact that that will have. We were talking earlier, there are 1 billion disabled people across the whole world.
Yeah.
And most of them, and many of them are not, you don't see it. It's invisible disability, yeah, right? We solve problems. We get someone or people, a preponderance of people at the table that can solve those problems. Yeah. The scale is amazing, right? And so that's where we want to be. We want to help you solve the problems that you see. And we want to get more people in there to help you do that. So thank you for being here. Thank you for listening to us. And I'm going to thank you in advance for communicating your needs, concerns, desires to us.
Yeah, and we're listening.
Okay.
So with that, I'm going to transition this to DEIB itself, right? Diversity, equity, yeah, inclusion. And the importance of that. We were discussing that it's under attack right now. And I love the way Brenda shares how important this work is. So I'm going to ask you to speak a little bit to the diversity, equity, inclusion side of things. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of DEIB folks in the house as well. Mm-hmm. It'll help.
Yeah. It's really critical work to do, and there's something in there for all of us. So I can stand here and I can explain to you why it's important. But if you're at a company, and let's say that you've solved something really important, like we have a partner in the US, PwC, who really does a good job with pay equity and pay parity. And so what we did is got a bunch of companies together, and we let PwC tell the story. Right? And the impact was amazing, because that's your colleague, right? They're doing the same types of things you're doing. They have the same challenges that you have for P&L and for all the things. And so being able to look to each other for those things that are hard and see people who have tried some things and share the things that worked, share the things that didn't work, right? So that some of us can save ourselves from those things that don't work, save ourselves time, money, stress, all those things, right? So that is important to know, that it's not just those of us who wear the DEIB label, which, you know, thank you to everybody in the audience that's doing that. It's important work. I shared with someone earlier, when I first took this job, my goal was to put myself out of business in a very short period of time. Unfortunately, I don't think I'm going to make it, but that just means that we need to stick with it. And we need to have that resolve, and we need to know that we are working together. We're all collaborating for this very important thing to get done. And what is the important thing? The important thing impacts economic success. It impacts community success. It impacts families. We were talking also about how women are putting their money together to, yeah, support each other as they create new businesses. In the US, 49% of the new businesses started since the pandemic are headed by women. Yet, we get funding in single digits. Right? And so many times we have to source fund and fund ourselves. Well, you know, that shouldn't be, yeah, but there's success even in that. because we're able to invest in things that are working, and we're able to invest in our own financial success. And so we figure out how to make lemonade out of those lemons, yeah. right? And out of it comes innovative new ideas, it comes new companies. Those new businesses are hiring people. So there's opportunity for people to work. Over half of the 70% of the people who are in poverty in the world are women and children. Yeah. And so if we can address pay parity, if we can address investment in women-led businesses, it works for everybody's GDP. Yeah. It supports everyone's communities, and it brings people out of poverty. And at my heart, that is one of the things that irks me the most. There is no reason for poverty. Right? Especially in the tech industry, we have the ability to impact it in that way. So diversity first comes from diversity of ideas. You know, I don't like to talk about myself at all, but I remember when I first started Computer Science for All, people were like, what are you even talking about? And it was irritating to me, but after a while, I was like, I'm onto something people are not talking about. I brought something no one else was talking about. That's not a pat on the back, that's a contribution. Right? That was something that was needed. So we want to encourage all people who are not doing what everybody else is doing, contribute, speak up, make a change, because it changes lives, it changes financial status, yeah. it changes GDP, it changes education, it changes all the things that we care about, right? Yeah. So that's diversity of thought, of background, of experience, of desire, all of that is what we're trying to do. It's not just one or two or three categories. It is when we're successful, we will look around and we will understand each other's language and background, and it'll just be normal. Yeah. And problems will be solved. And we won't recognize ourselves.
To that world, to that promise of the future. Yep. So with that, Brenda, I'm gonna do the last segment, which is a rapid fire. I didn't prepare you for this. But that's the fun of the rapid fire. You should know that it is a rapid fire. So I'm going to say a few words, and you tell us the first word or the phrase that comes to your mind when I say it.
Okay.
Diversity.
Everybody.
Inclusion.
Belonging.
Women.
Over half the population. Love. Support. Ideas. Nurture. Understanding. Inclusion. Brilliance.
Gender.
There's more than one, more than two.
Non-binary.
Non-binary, we are needing to include and understand more and more, and their people.
Differently abled.
Differently abled are a billion people.
And the last one, AnitaB.org.
We are the conduit to the future.
And on that note, audience, it's over to you for Q&A. If you have questions for Brenda or for me, please feel free to shoot for the next 10 or 15 minutes. And then let me also tell you, there are photo booths outside and there are instant prints. So if you've met friends you want pictures with, there's somebody who's going to take a picture and give you a physical copy, which hasn't happened in a very long time. So you don't have to go through your phone. You can actually tack it up on your desk. So make sure to enjoy the photo booth before you all leave. But now for questions. We do need you to use the mic for the video. So I'm going to request somebody to assist her with turning it on, please. Thank you.
Oh, there it goes.
Yeah, this is working now.
Yeah.
So hi, Brenda, and hi,
hi.
Shreya. And so nice to meet you and to hear your plans. Really, really excited about, Anita, you're coming to India all over again and, starting with the GHCI as well. And Shreya, kudos to you. A lot of energy that you are, exerting right now. It feels like we are in the right place and a lot of expectation, I must say.
Yeah. No pressure.
No pressure at all. All right. So I think two things I want to say. One is a question. Second is a little bit of reflection from the past interactions, etc. And I want to share with you. One, you did share about various areas and, where you would be focusing on. And you mentioned about people dropping out or leaving at certain ages or certain paths, and you mm-hmm. talked about returnship programs as well. But want to understand from you, what are we doing, or what will your organization do in terms of being the role model for, let's say, middle management and encouraging them to continue their career within the organization. So I think so that's what our data says, that after middle management, the numbers drastically drop. Mm-hmm. So that is one. Second, I think so an expectation or like reflection from the previous interactions, that there's a lot of work the GHCI did, especially at the ground level, to get the talent, et cetera, and stuff. Yes. But I think so what happened over a period of time, because there is the scale in India is large, we were not really able to get the good talent from these, from our interaction with GHCI. So any ideas, how are you going to navigate this time to ensure that we get the right talent? Because I think so scale is not a problem, but it's the quality that needs to be maintained, you know, at the ground level.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to answer the first part about, you know, what are we doing to make things different? One of the programs that we didn't talk about, I talked about us focusing on the top three layers of management and really building the pathways into leadership for women, and also doing an education at the leadership level for everybody that's already there to make sure that the culture is different and working together on that. We are also creating an executive pathway at our conferences where we focus just in on executive leadership. We are creating a program that is a peer-to-peer program that is for C-level women and near C-level women. I myself went through a CEO training that was transformational. I don't know many people how you get into being CEOs. It's an organic pathway. You know, you knew one thing and you went up through leadership and you became a CEO, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, I got to do all these things, and you figure it out and you bumble around, right? And so there's this program that was created to strengthen CEOs that was life changing. And so one of the things that myself and a few of the leaders and actually the chair of our board decided is, what if we were to start with that training and then put together a peer-to-peer group that lasted all year long? And you had, again, it's a community of like-minded women who are learning the same things, and they're bouncing their experiences off each other, not unlike what we do at Grace Hopper Celebration, right? And so really focusing in on what are the pain points of the women who get almost there and they can't get into leadership, or they get into leadership and they're isolated, and they don't have others to look to. They don't have their, you know, what we would call a kitchen cabinet. You know, these people that you know you can count on, that, you know, you've been trained with, you meet them once a month, twice a month, all year long. That makes a big difference. Even in, you know, for technical women, period, to have that group of women that they could reach out to. One of the things that Anita started was sisters, and that was what sisters did, was to create that technical community that you could call on to get help with your whatever project you were on or whatever was going on. So we want to do that at the executive level. So we're excited about that program. In terms of how do we get the talent there? So one of the things Shreya and I have been talking about is part of the issue that we're addressing is how we absorb the misogyny ourselves, and that barrier starts in us because we've been told what we can't do, what we shouldn't say, or I'm trying to be like him because that's what's successful. And so in the work that we do with women, if we can build it, many times the women who are able to do the jobs don't come for them, or they've had their children and now they feel like they're out of it. And as we've talked to the community, we find that even 6 months off the job, women begin to say to themselves, I'm not sharp anymore, I can't go back. Well, we know that that's not the case, right? So building in in the population of women is beyond just those coming out of college. It's those that have experience. And so those coming out of college, maybe they can jump in, but we know where they go is to entry level. What about the ones that have that great experience that are taking themselves onto the sideline? So that's an important piece of work for us to do that would bring that talent back, right? That has talked themselves out of being there. It's interesting how if we would spend time even in introspection, which I have done, I can give you a little testimony myself. Megan Smith, who was Obama's CTO, was the one that I got to work with when we were working on the Computer Science for All initiative. She actually threw my hat in the ring for this job. I didn't know about it. I didn't know about AnitaB.org. The recruiter called me. I argued, long story short, for 2 months. It was the 2 months before I called the recruiter. Then I argued with him for 6 weeks before I sent him my resume. I was like, why would they want me? I don't understand. What do I have? I don't know anything. Why would they want me? And it turns out that all of the experiences, all of the things that I had run into from education and getting into tech in the first place and getting promoted, all of that prepared me. Yeah. But I argued 3 months, right? So I had to take a look at myself and say, if, you know, I'm pointing at other women, we do that. We think, and the data shows, we think we have to know 100% of what that job description describes, and then we make up other stuff that's not there before we even try. Whereas men, what is it, 40% or something like that?
Yeah, 40.
Right? So that's a serious amount of work, but that's where the community comes in. When you can sit amongst women who've done what you think you can't do, and then you compare resumes or you compare experiences and you go, she did that? Maybe I can do that. And the issue is that's why community is so important. It takes more than just one time. Yeah. I got to get with you. You know, I was encouraging everybody else and discounting myself, right? So that's a huge amount of work. And there's work for companies to do internally around those same things. What pictures are up on your wall? Are they all men? Does that send a signal that success is only male? Whose pictures are on the wall at the university? Who do we see as we drive down the street that advertises tech? I could even say, there was a picture, I was in Atlanta in the US, and there was this picture, this image, and it said something, it was an Apple picture about something about tech. And I remember looking at the picture, and even I was startled, because we're so used to one image.
Yeah.
Images count. Yeah. Images count for the mothers and the fathers who dissuade the female technologists from continuing. Everybody needs to see it. I was even talking to a leader on my podcast who used to be in Hollywood. She did directing.
Yeah.
And she said that, I told her, I said, you know what we need? Because I didn't know this. Maybe I don't know if you know this. Hollywood impacts 70% of the world watch Hollywood movies.
Yeah.
Most sexist movies on the planet, right? They even counted how many times women speak versus how many times men speak.
There are 2.4 women for every man. There are 2.4 men for every woman in every movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even if she's in the movie, she doesn't speak.
Yeah.
Right? And so if you're getting this dose of who speaks, who shows up, who's running things, who's doing things, who has power, that affects everybody, the men and the women. And so I was like, we need to create a sitcom or something where the woman is the dean of the university or whatever, so that the people who put those barriers up, the teachers, the counselors, because we come through all of those people and we absorb all of that stuff that tell us as a PhD that we shouldn't come and work for your company. It's ridiculous, right? But it's the work.
Yeah.
It's like I said, what is the work? If that's the work, then that's what we'll do.
My NLP guide, he said once that we are spitting out the rotten watermelon seeds we swallowed when we are young all through our life. It almost seems like that.
Yeah.
But speaking about, Brenda, what we were talking to, right? it's great that you want a diverse organization, but our colleague Bo Young Lee says this always. It's great to want to be diverse, but are you inclusive? Because as long as you're diverse, people are going to leave because your culture is not inclusive. You've hired the people, but once they get in the door, there's nothing that has changed in the environment, right? So it's to that, to the first answer to your first question. And the second one, what are we going to do? I think the cross-section is different, firstly, because there's been a hiatus. All of the women who attended GHC in 2019, who are probably starters, are probably already with 6 years of experience now. We hope to bring them all back in. That's one. The cross-section is also how we look at early starters, how we look at mid-career, how we look at... And now that we know that the focus is this, our content, both within the organization, both the run-up to the, to the conference itself, all of that is going to want us to engage more with that community. And our community does have a very nice intersection of that. We will introduce you to the team that's going to be working on this. And we want to assure you that GHCI is no more unidimensional. It's not that one place where you come and you know, I've heard people say, oh, it's poaching ground. Why would we send our people there? Or it's learning ground. It's networking ground. It's celebration ground, right? That's what we're trying to do. And we are trying to ensure that there's something in it for everybody. And the, we have multiple tracks across tech. Like I said, we have a DIB track. We have an exec leadership track. We have a media track because we believe that the media is co-creators, like you said, about Hollywood. How are we covering? How are our spokespeople speaking? How is diversity, equity, inclusion showing up across the board? So, you know, really looking at that and building up towards it. GHCI is not endgame. GHCI is one of the many milestones in the many, many years that are going to come through for Anita B in India. So it's not synonymous with each other. The work that we're going to do, it's one of the many things that we'll do. So.
And you're already helping because what you said, I'm going to take that with me. Right? Like, okay, all right. That's on the menu. And it's really important because we know that you need talent and we know that you need great talent. And so we're going to make sure that that great, that it exists, but that they actually come and that you can find them.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. We have Pratik and then we have Deepa. Yes.
Yes. Hi, Brenda.
Hi.
Lovely to be here. And when I'm hearing you, there's a lot of pressing questions that come up to me, but then let me, put my thoughts together. One, we're talking about equality, gender equality, and I feel there is going to be a bigger missing pie if we don't look at the intersectional lens.
Oh, absolutely.
And I can share where I'm coming from, and I love the quote that you made, the contribution. So I joined the industry 15 years back. And I was part of a women's network, and I felt I didn't fit in there because, one, of course, my first identity is women, of course, but then there were a lot of things that I wanted to bring from a perspective of being a woman with disability. Today, 15 years down the lane, we have progressed, but it's been really slow. Mm-hmm. And Pratik holding the mic, we need more and more people talking about assistive technology. And of course, we need dollars. We need people to give dollars for that, right? It's not going to come in easy. But why aren't we accelerating? Why aren't we giving that? Or else, talking about gender equality, we're missing a bigger, bigger pie if we are not looking at the intersectional lens of, say, women with disability or women from a trans community, the mind shift. We're just going to still be laid back. And after 10 years, we're going to say, can we move up, right? And I feel we're still backward. I know these needs dollars, but how do we accelerate? How do we make that push happen? I would love to hear from you on that.
Well, absolutely. And then Shreya can share specifics about what we're doing here in India. But the shift that we made a couple years ago for Anita B Corporate US was to be more inclusive around disability, to be more inclusive around non-binary and trans community, was to start to talk about it. So to put things in perspective, right, we've been around for almost 30 years. When Anita started, she made a saying, 50-50 by 2020. Okay, that was very, binary, but it was meaningful at the time. At the time, women in the U.S. were 35% of tech. We've not been that ever since. think we might be 27% now. At one point, it went down to as low as 12%. The political winds will, you know, we take a step forward, we take a step back. We have to resource ourselves and come back again. And so it is taking us way more time, and I'm not a patient type. I'm going to tell you, I'm not. I want it right now. But it takes a persistence and an agility to change as the winds change. You know, Bo will talk about, you know, we call it DEI now, but it has been called so many different things because it gets co-opted and distorted. And so then we have to create a new name. So this is a long-term fight. Invisible in the community have been the intersections. I love the conversation around intersectionality because we can't get this done successfully if we don't know that the experience of a person who is a woman is maybe, and that's how she identifies herself, is probably different from a woman where there's ageism. She's an older woman, different from a woman who has a visible disability versus an invisible disability, versus a woman who's from a rural area. We talk about even New York City, which is a huge state, has very rural parts. So if you have an indigenous woman who lives on a reservation, she's going to have a totally different experience from a woman who lives in Manhattan, right? One of the biggest cities in the world. And so not thinking about that, not bringing that to bear, it misses a lot of the point, which is why that progress is not felt. That's where education and having these conversations, like everybody just heard what you said. They may not have thought about it before today. They may go, oh, I forgot. I remembered that from a year ago. Having the conversations over and over again, that's for any educators in the room. Can you say something once to a student and they get it? No, it's this, and it's worse with grown folk. It's worse, right? We've got to say these things over and over again. We have to have more and more ways of saying them. And in images, one of the things we do at the Grace Hopper Celebration, if you look up at the banners that are there, if any of you have been there, everybody is represented. Yes. You look up and you see yourself. That is critical. And many people don't understand how important it is. I need to see somebody that looks like me to feel included. Yep. Inclusion.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, and I tell y'all all my business. So before I came to work for the organization, I got to come to Grace Hopper Celebration once. And I came in, and at the time, it was at 8,000 people. You know, we're at 25,000. There was a table. We had badges, right? There was a table where there were all these flags that you could add to your badge. And I'm telling you, there was every flag on the planet. There was green hair. I have green hair. You know, I'm from the city. I'm from not from the city. And there was one space that said black people. Not African, not, you know, it was just black. And guess what? There were no flags. And I looked around. And I was like, there aren't very many of us here. How is it that green hair, right? Yeah. And I felt that. It was a wonderful conference, but I felt that, right? Just like you're feeling, why am I not included? So all the leaders in the room, you have to show people that they're on your mind. I have four kids. They're not one of them is alike. You would think, and they same mama, daddy, they're 7 years from beginning to end. It was like boom, boom, boom. Not alike at all. I cannot treat any of them the same. You wouldn't expect me to, right? So why is it in our companies and in our universities do we think that there's a one size fits all for everybody? So we have to change our minds. And we can't say, well, that's too much work. Well, is it? Do you want to be successful? Then you've got to do the work. Which means you've got to talk about these things. You've got to put the images up. And so we're about that life. We're about making sure that the intersections are discussed. We're about changing language. Language is so critical. How do you say things? Even when I was taking my CEO training, it was a man that was teaching it. And he was like, well, when the boss says something, he. And my board chair said, or she.
Yeah.
or they. Yeah. You know, we just kept reminding him that his language was important. We also have to do that. Yeah. So I don't know if I answered your question, but I just want you to know that I feel everything that you said. And it is in our plans and in our in our strategies.
Yeah, absolutely. And to say that, Pratik, who's holding the mic for you, was our first conduit when we started speaking. And he was telling us how women with differently abled entrepreneurial journeys are that much more, you know, struggling because they don't have the wherewithal. And one of the things we surely want to do and we want to replicate is something called Pitch Her and the entire ecosystem of accelerating and creating the dollars that you're very much speaking about by not just advocacy, but also policy, because public policy is something else that we're going to be bringing in as well. So no more is, like I said, Anita, we unidimensional. We are going to be working with the very partner that's holding the mic for you. ATF is already a collaborator, and we hope to move the needle with partners like you as well, Deepa, because that was my next ask. Will you join us as we do this? Because we need you as well on the table.
I think I'll be more than happy to do that. And I love how Brenda said, you know, I'm also someone who can't be, you know, calm enough to make this, accelerate this, or make a big push to it. And just on the language, when we spoke about, it's always women with disability. The word differently abled is an outdated word.
Yeah.
I just want to address that here, saying that let's not use it. I know it's, you know, 10 years back, I kept telling my boss, he said, specially abled. I said, no, you know, we can't have that word. But today I just tell him, boss, you can't do it. Outdated. Can you?
Well put.
No, the community is progressed. You know, everything around us is progressing. Please use your language. So it is always persons with disability or women with disability. And there's also other terminologies. If you want to address someone who's visually impaired, it's someone with blindness. The community is okay to call themselves blind.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think every one of us to be aware of that, that's a big ask. Like Brenda said, it's always that we need to remind ourselves, how do we include them? Yeah. And don't have too many apprehensions, ask them. Yeah. They're not out. You know, you can just check in with them to say, how do you prefer to be called? Or how do you prefer to be addressed? But thank you so much for that. I would love to be part of it and see how we can actually do it.
And I'd also like to say, if there's anybody in here, because there's tech people all over the room, if you're creating tech for disabled people, make sure that disabled people get to test it.
Yep.
So I came here with a request. Hi, Brenda, this is Pratik, and I came here into this room with thinking of making a request. So we represent 450 innovators and startups in assistive technology building solutions for various kind of disabilities. So it's a very large ecosystem in India as we speak today. But when I think of these 450 innovators and entrepreneurs, I see a very small percentage of women with disabilities who are taking that baton. And while we think about drop rate in startups in general is very high, drop rate in terms of women with disability doing these startups is very, very high. And the request was obviously to do some program collaboration together with Anita B to make that, you know, to move the needle. But now I see where Shreya and yourself committing and Deepa being in, it's no more a request. It's almost an initiative already. So thank you very much. And big round of applause to all of you guys.
Excited to. Excited. Thank you.
Krishnan.
Thank you, Brenda. And very excited to have Anita be back here. And you got the right person to lead it in the next phase of growth. So. mine is a tinge of a concern in the sense that while there are so many things which are moving forward, at the same time, we are also seeing some wins, especially in from the U.S. in the recent legislations, legal activism, which is actually undermining many of the work and even negating some of the work in the space. And as in many other areas, you know, U.S., whether you like it or not, U.S. leads and the world follows in many ways. And the concern is that this could also get picked up in many quarters around the world, including India. And how do we as a community respond to it? How do we navigate through that and not lose the momentum which has been built up over the last decade or so?
Well, here's my response to that. And, you know, I say this to leaders and in the U.S. as well. We are a very powerful community. Tech is everywhere. Tech controls so many things. If we put our foot down and say we're not going to do that, we could actually be the leaders. That's what I'm looking for in the U.S. I'm looking for those tech leaders to say, this is foolishness. We're not going to follow. You know, you've touched on something very near and dear to my life. The pressure to erase all of African-American history is there. They're banning books that even have a name of a black person in it. It's insidious. But it doesn't have to be. It's like people are following like sheep instead of standing up and saying, I'm not going to do it. We have the resources, the wherewithal, the power. We don't need to do what everybody else is doing. We innovate in so many areas. That's the name of tech, right, is innovation. We ought to innovate in this way, too. It's like, no, we're not going to do that. We have talked about all night about the reasons why diversity is important. We have reasons to stand our ground. We just need to do it. And so I'm encouraged by the progress that is being made in India. Help us set the example. I'm just so encouraged. Please don't follow this nonsense that we're doing. Please don't. Right? And I feel like I'm hoping that the pendulum, you know, they talk about the pendulum swinging. I'm hoping it's almost ready to come back because it just doesn't make sense. We want to serve more of a population. I don't know any business that doesn't want more customers. Yeah. Anti-diversity is against a customer base. It's against the development of your country, of your neighborhoods, of your society, the very fabric of your society. We are intelligent thinking people. We can carry that message. We can do that. We don't have to follow. I think sometimes thinking people overthink. Right? If it's nonsense, we should just call it nonsense. My parents are Southern, the Southern part of the United States, so I grew up with all those Southern stayings. You know, I'm going to use a little of my accent. We used to say we ought to be smart as an old cow and know how to eat the grass and leave the sticks, right? If we can't take the data in, and know when there's junk and leave it, then I don't know what's wrong with us. So please, don't follow it. Don't stand your ground. Stand your ground.
Let's hug the trees. The axes will fall. Yes, here. Oh, careful.
Hi, Brenda.
Hi,
Shreya. It's really exciting to be here. And I should say, when I heard that GHCI is happening in November, I was super excited. My very first conference, which I visited in Bangalore, I come to my office and I see mostly men and very few women. And that was the very first experience where I saw everywhere women. All women.
Okay. Life-changing, like, isn't it?
For the first time, I saw maybe very few men and all the women, and they were feeling uncomfortable. I was like, wow, this does happen.
Yeah.
So once I left the conference, I was super excited and buzzed off for so long. And we had a meeting within the organization, within my organization, and I imparted all the things I learned, all the things I saw. And my male manager actually encouraged me to do so. I was so inspired by Anita B at that time. Now being here, I'm like really happy. So there is one thing I wanted to ask. I know we have very few leaders in the executive level who are women. I'm not touching the non-binary because it's really a touchy subject in India, definitely. So coming to the little greater population, women, so what I see is we have very few because the pyramid shape which is there and we don't have too many executive positions. So I was speaking to one of my senior women leaders and we were talking about our topic and she suddenly said, see, now I'm a VP here. I don't think they will make me a senior VP anymore. they don't have positions. I was like little discouraged, thinking that why? Why this is the only avenue for me to grow and show that this is where I'm supposed to be. Just because I don't have a title doesn't mean that I don't deserve it. And it doesn't need to be in the same organization. And that brought me to do some research to understand different types of CEOs and CFOs and CFO, all the executive level. And I was looking at all the big companies. And I was so surprised to see many Indians, but they are not based out of India. Yeah. They're all out of India. Yeah. And all of them got education out of India, not in India. They at least had their MBAs and their PhDs, everything out of India. That's good. You're getting exposure and you're understanding the world. And they settled there. We don't need to name them, you know.
Yes.
But my thing is, why can't we stay in India, make a change in India? Why can't I be a CEO or a CIO here? Why can't a US company have an Indian CEO or an Indian executive? What? We can, we're doing a lot of difference. So why is it not possible?
It is possible. It is possible. The longest distance, my mother would tell me, to truth is between here and here. This 6 inches or however wide it is. We think we have to continue to do the same thing over and over again, which is why most of the leadership is male, period. And then now we can start to talk about nationality and where people are from. I first wanted to speak to your experience at Grace Hopper. I had the same experience. Sitting in that room and looking around, I remember I was listening to who was on the stage. I think it was the CEO of Microsoft. What's his name? I always forget his name.
Satya Nadella.
Yeah, Satya Nadella was talking to a college leader. And, you know, they were having a conversation. And in fact, he said some interesting things that particular day. But I'm listening, and he said a couple interesting things, but I was I was looking around at all the women going, oh, my God. I mean, it's a myth buster. Because we're looking at ourselves, we're like, we exist. Smart, brilliant women who want to be in tech, who want to do this thing. And it's life-changing for us. But it's also, as you said, life-changing for the men. Yeah. I had male teachers who would go, I would send to Grace Hopper, and it would revolutionize their classroom. Because all of a sudden, they understood the physicality of being in the minority. You know, it's an intellectual thing is one way, but when you physically have experienced something, it's life-changing. It gives you that empathy. And they would come back and it would change their classrooms. And so the experience, you know, I'll have companies that I'll invite. I'll say, you should come, male leaders, come to Grace Hopper. And they'll send their women. And I'll go, well, that's nice, but I invited you because you would be changed. And then you would go back and make a change in your organization. So the work, you know, I always want to say it's not just about women and non-binary people. It's about all of us understanding what diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging means. And it means getting uncomfortable sometimes, right? So he was not used to being uncomfortable. And he learned what it was like. And so all of a sudden he had empathy for his students and so much changed. He went on to lead a lot of the work that I did around democratizing computer science. So that's really, really critical. I just wanted to say that. It's multi-layered the work.
Yeah, and also the fact that you said non-binary is very touchy. It's time to make it untouchy. Let's hug, let's embrace, let's change that narrative.
Yeah.
If we don't do it in this room, I don't know who will, right? So it's about time that we really embraced our, you know, and gender today, by the way, there are 26 recognized genders in the world. Gender is a spectrum. It's no more binary and just two or three others. So I'm sorry, I'm going to have to call time because we're almost on time. And I also want to quickly introduce the India team. We also have Quinton Sproul, our Deputy Chief of Staff, who's quite the rock star himself, who's joined us here today. The two of them traveled from the US and then to Qatar in here. We also have our team. We have Karen, Pranalika, Durga. I'm going to ask you to come here. It's not so easy, please. you'll need to introduce yourselves and tell us what you all do so people get to know the work that you do. Yeah. Now.
Hello. Hi, everyone. I'm Karen DeMello. I head the community here in India. I have had the privilege of working in the social impact space for the last 15 years and in assistive tech for the last 5. When I talk about the community, we have an extremely large, active, growing one, despite the hiatus that we've had. And while I'm only looking to grow it, in my role, I'm looking to be a facilitator, an advocate, an ally, and I'm really looking forward to making sure to create safe spaces and making sure that everyone's voices are heard, their needs are met, their aspirations supported. Speaking of community, we have two volunteers who've come from different states to help us for such a small event. They're the same women leading our digital literacy program that we were talking about earlier. So hugely inspired, and I'm really looking forward to meeting all of you. And all of the work that we want to do is only possible through collaborative work, and not just in this room, take it outside of it and make sure it happens. So let's make a positive impact, make meaningful change together, and looking forward to it. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Pranalika Mahanta. I am the head of head of marketing and events for Aditya B India. I joined around 2 months back. Really, really, really grateful for this great turnout today. I have around 13 years of experience in marketing communication. I have consciously made this effort to move towards creating an impact that I can see immediately. So I am grateful, I am excited, and I am super pumped for all the things that we have in store for everybody, our community members, our corporate partners, and leaders those are our flag bearers. Trust, they are the backbones of, you know, what Aditya B does globally and in India, and especially our corporate partners. Also, I want to say that we have a lot more in store, not just GHCI. I know GHCI is the biggest one, and trust me, it is going to be bigger, better, and very, very different this time. So looking forward to having the conversations with all of you, for collaborating, for support, and as always, looking forward to do some amazing work with all of you. Thanks so much.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Durga Gokul. I'm the content and social media manager for Aditya B. It's only been 3 weeks that I've joined here, and the energy is insane. It's amazing. So I've been working for like over 20 clients across many industries, but this one is very close to my heart, and it's the first time I'm in the DIEB space, and I'm looking forward to creating magic and telling all your stories in the best possible way and making sure that Aditya B is known for lots of things and not just GHCI. So yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Quinton, if he can get you up here, and we'll take one Aditya B picture. There's also Richa Bhandari, who's joining us in 2 weeks. She's going to be helping us with marketing and ops. So we have future people joining in as well. There's another colleague from Gurgaon who couldn't make it because she's still on her notice period. And so the team is growing. We are infusing ourselves with not just our own internal teams, but Prashant, Pratik, Antra, Anju, Shridevi, these are all people who are part, and Jacinta, who are all running wonderful organizations that are working with women, children, impact, all of these spaces. So looking to collaborating with all of them to really build something that's cohesive. We have Ashok from NASCOM, who spent years in NASCOM DEIB. I know what a flag bearer he's been. He's great. He came with black hair and a lot more hair on his head, and now he's great. And that's the number of years and the number of hairs that have turned gray for having worked in the space with the experience that he has. So this room is full of potential, and we're really looking forward to working with all of you. And if we can quickly take a picture of Team Aditya B, and then everybody in the room, if we can fit you all into a picture just after this one, we will try and attempt that too. So,
how are we doing? I just want to say thank you again to those of you who knew us from before and that you came back. Thank you, because you've been a part of our community for a long time, and it's very meaningful to me. Thank you.
everybody, if we can have the honor of a photograph with everybody in the room, because you're all, by extension, Anita B as well. And I have a few thank yous to say. Thank you to On Purpose Consulting, our entire amazing, magical reputation team that works with us on all the initiatives that we take. Event You Rocks, our events team that has put together this very fancy, very lovely looking event. We have multiple collaborators and co-creators, and we want to thank them all. And of course, thank you, lovely audience, for showing up in the numbers that you have. We have small town folks who are doing our podcast. We're launching a podcast. You'll hear more Women's Month. So small town folks is working with us to create the podcast. So to many, many more collaborations and creative ways of engaging, thank you all so much. Now you can come for the photo. I thought I'll talk as I direct you all so that we'll save time, but thank you, audience. Come in, come in.
Hey, look at me, look at me. Smile, please. Don't close your eyes, please.
That's ambitious.
Yes, ready? Smile.
Nobody blink. Say, please. Excuse me.
Ma'am, ready? Look here. One more.
Big smile.
This is just the beginning. Okay.
Wait. Andrew, come back. Okay, come back. She's okay, the last one in a photograph. Yes. Somebody's iPhone. All right.
She said it.